250, and then I backed it back down. I think I walked away with like 204. Started my day off nice. Easy to get to, too. You know where it's at? It's just right off the 101. It's like, literally, it's like 12 minutes from here. Only problem is they allow smoking in there.
Oh, really?
At the casinos out in Colorado, there's no smoking. So, you can't... It's the one thing. I'm surprised I didn't wind up in the mine thing. It's really... I mean, you feel like you're smoking. You know? Oh, my God. Kicking out the car.
And then Minnesota lets us smoke in. They'll have some designated non-smoking areas, but even there, you know, it's better.
Yeah. California, they have non-smoking portions, but the problem with California is they put all the shitty tables and all the shitty games in the non-smoking area, you know? They know you're spending money, so... I thought I'd go before it got too busy. Saturday nights are usually pretty casinos. Can't get on any tables. Especially the craps tables. And then what a lot of casinos will do, as soon as the craps tables fill up consistently, they'll raise their minimums. So they'll go from like a $5 table. As soon as they fill up, they'll go to a $10 table. And if it stays full, they'll jump up to a $20 table. And $20 a table. Yep.
Yeah, same. I remember this once I went up to a way back when I went up to Fargo, they had quarter tables.
Yeah.
It was cool, except for then when you started winning and went up your bed, it's like max of $2.
Right,
and you're
right.
Like, oh, really?
Right. But you know what? It's funny you should mention that, because in Colorado, like on the weekdays, like Wednesday afternoon from, you know, 9 to 5 or 9 to 6, they do like a dollar table. And I've actually won the most money I've ever won throwing dice at a dollar table. Because I was just like, I was playing a lot of horn bets. So I was, you know, I was playing 12s and, you know, snake eyes. And I just kept throwing money down on the horns and the hard ways.
Right.
And they were hitting. So I was, you know, that's the most money I've ever won on a craps table. There was another time on a Friday night, though, this table was packed. And this guy was hot, rolling. And I was just praying somebody would walk away from the table, and no one did. I couldn't get on the freaking table. He must have been there. I stood there for at least 40 minutes. He must have hit at least 7 out of 10 rolls. Something for the table. The table was going nuts. I mean, you'd have thought we were in Vegas. And this is a little old gambling hill town, Central City, Blackhawk in Colorado, you know? It was crazy. I could not get on the table. I was like, please, somebody, leave the table. No one was budging.
Right, man.
They were rolling. Yeah, they just kept rolling. He kept hitting all his points. You know, you win a little house money and you start getting risky, right? So that's how I play anyways. I'll play conservative with my money, but I win some stuff. I'll start hedging my bets. I'll start playing hard ways. I'll start playing in the horn.
Zero,
zero. Zero, zero's time.
I thought she said zero. Oh, I thought he said zero, too. There's a horse track here, too. In Paradise? Up in Scottsdale?
Where did you say Colorado are you from?
Parker, east of Parker, which is a suburb you're familiar at all with
Colorado Springs.
Okay, it's north of Colorado Springs by a ton. Well, not by a ton, but about, oh gosh, 70 miles, 60 miles.
So north of Denver?
Southeast of Denver. Yeah, southeast by about 30 miles.
Stayed up there for 3 years.
What's that?
Oh, you lived in Colorado Springs.
Oh, okay. Were you in the Air Force or something?
No. Dad was a mercenary. I was in the Philippines for 13 years.
Oh, where at? Subic? Manila?
Manila, Venezuela, Bulacan.
Uh-huh. I've been to the Philippines a million times. I was in the Navy.
Okay.
corpsman in the Navy, so worked in physical and occupational therapy most of my career at Balboa Naval Hospital in San Diego. Yeah, I've been overseas twice. Smelly there, man. Smelly. Hot summer day. Last place you want to be is outside. Oh my god. Especially in Subic Bay, you know, they have that river that runs around the bay.
Oh.
And that's what they use for their sewage.
Go swimming.
They, you know what? They dive in it for pesos, man. You see the Marines on the beach, on the bridge that leads you off base. And they call them ship river queens. These women are dressed up in like wedding gowns and stuff. And they're in these little canoe paddle boats. And they have these long butterfly nets, and the Marines will be throwing these giant peso dollars off and catching these. Well, the ones that they miss, these kids, they can't be boarded. Now, this is murky shit water, right? But I'm not kidding you. It's darker than that brown carpet. Brown floor. And these kids dive in. I mean, their immune systems must be like, bring on anything, bring on malaria. Malaria runs from these kids. But it's unbelievable.
You know, 131.
When I was there, I don't know what it's like now. I hadn't been there in years. But when I was there, it was impoverished. I mean, it's not hard to imagine why terrorism can weasel its way in there, you know, and some of these Al Qaeda groups and shit. Doubles until 4 o'clock tonight. Today is the final, men's final against the Rojas. I think we might be playing Bobby Horn. David Bobby Horn.
2:31.
Is Horn on the other side? The horn's at the bottom. Collins and the, yeah. Okay, that's what I got.
3:31.
There's Charlie Pratt today for a chance at the team qualifying championship. That one is tomorrow at like 1:20.
1:33.
Thank you.
hit. Two bounces. 5.33. Taylor. 7.30. Six, 33. Short. Second, third.
I was so late on my call. I think he was going to go in. There's been a few shorts where he's like, the player ruined the play, but that's what he's doing. And then if they don't, if they want to do it, that's exactly what he's doing. I don't think he's on.
Hold it. Six, 30.
My double start kind of locked in this match. And this will try to try $5 to left for him.
That
was your double. That's your doubles partner.
No,
my
doubles partner was gonna call, and I put $5,000.
Oh, he paid him $5 more to hit.
Oh, and get 15.
So he's getting 25.
I assume with these matches they go. Are you comfortable? Are you strong? Right.
No, I think on these they try to get a certified. We try to look for a certified rep. And the certifieds get $20.
Is it 20 or 15?
20. And the non-certifieds get 10.
Okay.
Last night they were so desperate. They were throwing another lots at people, you know.
Well, yeah, because people lose and it's like one drive home.
You see them.
What are you going to do?
Keep for $10. Keep for $10.
Yeah.
You paid $10 for your referee fee.
Which is
a smart idea.
But you still have to pay somebody else.
Pay somebody else. But they also ask you if you want the money or you want to donate it back to the U.S. So I would say probably 60% of us say, go ahead and keep it.
Okay.
$10. $100, I'll take it. It's $10.
Yep, everyone's got their price.
Right.
Start here and you want to go all the way across as far as
all
you can go.
It's like, man. You know who does that too?
They Yeah.
He put out, did you ever see that video of the coach's toolbox? Did you ever watch that?
No.
He put it out like, I don't know, maybe 10 years ago, 15 years ago.
I know.
The sneaky trail of all this silly shit in there. Like, lay down in front of the door when your opponent arrives for his warm up and pretend you're sleeping.
It's just
nonsensical bullshit. You're like, really, dude? That's funny. Like, you're not interested, you know? Wear colorful clothes, you know, beanie caps. And
there are those things. You get that guy that wants you to shoot. Like, slow him down a little bit, right? Get in their head.
I actually face this guy quite a bit. Does a lot of that shit, man. He'll take it right to like 9 seconds, and then he'll drop his rack. So he'll wait for the call, and then he'll wait a couple of seconds, just as you're prepping, and then he'll throw his rack.
So you know what the rule actually is?
As soon as the call's made, so 10 seconds, right?
His score gets called. If you see him and you look away, done.
Right.
So they have rules thing, they have the guy up front, the score gets called, and as he's walking by, the guy is standing there. He walks up to the box and turns, and gets ready to serve. The guy puts his racket up. At that point, he's already looked because he walked to the box. When the score is called, you visually see that he's not turned, which seems kind of weird because I've always thought it's like once you get to the box, you're ready. Which is kind of how you play it when you, because I know when I call to score, I call it when I get to the box.
Right.
But in a tournament,
when you have the ref,
when you have the ref, it's as soon as the ref calls it, if you're in the ready position, and as soon as you're done, you get the ref. Unless it sees you.
Yeah, but I've seen it happen here several times this weekend, and it must just
that's the way
it
always seems to call.
Right,
which is actually wrong.
I've seen guys like, okay, the guy calls the score, somebody's in the box, and it starts to bounce, and he sets the serve, and the guy will put up his hand, and I've even seen these guys that don't, like, the rules clear, so you gotta go over your head. This guy's
just
here.
It's just a tip.
Good shot. I call it a good shot.
I was going to double check with Otto on that. But
I thought you had to go clearly above your head with your racket. These guys are going like right here.
Yeah.
So
it's
like, so do this. You know?
I'll do this back behind.
Oh, yeah. Or here you go. Ready, sir?
Right out.
Yep.
You know, wipe your brow.
That's not where I walk to the back with one of those guys. And you push the turn halfway, and then you don't turn. And then the serve when you're facing the back.
Right.
You thought I turned,
yeah.
And you serve right away, which means you were trying to catch me, not in a ready position. Right? It's like you were doing that on purpose. But you're going to turn.
And he's reffing Ruben and Hatch against Steven. I forgot Steven's partner's name, but Steven. He's like this. So he's waiting for Hatch. But Hatch really wasn't paying attention. Because it is up to your partner in the doubles box to be looking at. Steven did one of these deals.
But he did a hand?
Yeah, and he did a free hand up in the air.
No hands, just like that.
He had his hands
up. That don't count.
Oh, I thought it counted.
That don't count.
Sure.
It's got to be
all of him. Anyway, he sent Hatch through the roof.
Good.
But he actually
recorded
Hatch. This makes him
5:39.
Stuff happened. Oh,
really?
After I walked away.
Whoa.
Told me he was going to beat his ass or some bullshit nonsense.
It's funny how many hot hits are in
there. Yeah. That's a good shot.
Yeah. That's my shot.
Got out. 9:35.
Looks like we're going to have a tiebreaker. Maybe not. Let's go.
Keep it tight.
Side out. 5:39.
These are cool shoes.
Those? Which ones?
Rondo's. Remember if she did the sticker on the back or if that's the shoe design.
Door. Next serve.
Which one?
two bounds. Side out.
I don't think that's a sticker.
Sure, 9:35. Sure. Third.
Look like these shoes.
Yankees.
Two bounces.
I used to do Asics, Electro Gel.
Yeah.
For flannel.
10:35.
These band shoes by Under Armour. They have, these are actually lacrosse shoes. They have a little cleat at the bottom of them. And so I do a lot of metabolic training with TRX.
I'm actually familiar with TRX.
Mm-hmm. And so when I would do a low row, any other shoe I wore, whether it was Nike, Adidas, whatever, would slide on the floor. So as I change the vector to get more resistance,
right.
If the anchor point is here, my upper body's here, or these are my feet, when I change the vector, my feet would slide.
Until
I put these dangies on, now they just stick. It doesn't matter. I could get like this, and they just stick to the floor.
That's cool.
So I started playing with them a little bit. Now I still play with the head dummy, the Sonic dummy. But I'm thinking just about playing the knees from the room. And I told Gearbox, they don't have a shoe yet. And I said, you guys should team up with Under Armour.
13:35.
A good shoe, you know? So, but those heads... Head shoes, every time I wear them, my plantar fasciitis flares up, man, the next day. And I've got an
ulcer that did not well, and I get that back again. That was awful.
Oh, it's so painful. Yeah, but it's only really the first couple steps in the morning. Once I get going a little bit, I get some circulation in there, and it kind of calms down, you know. But man, before that circulation gets in there to soften that fascia, until that fascia gets a little more pliable, oh my God. You have it in your heel, or you have it in your arch?
Heel.
Yeah.
Actually, I also have it. There's, it's called something different when it's in that tendon. I have little nubs in there. It hasn't really hurt unless you push on the little nubs or the minor or something else.
Second third.
It's actually good old.
What's that? Yeah. Look much older than me.
14:35.
53. Yeah.
Oh my God.
But it does.
I remember when you turn 30, it's like, oh my God.
I know, right?
Now it's like, oh, I wish.
I've forgotten more stuff, man. Nice.
6:30:14.
14:37. Choked up on
it. She's just hanging a little too much left center instead of coming back completely. Step that shot. Very good recovery.
Here we go. We get some points here.
7:30:14. Out.
That was easy.
14:37. Serve, Tim. Next serve. No, dig it.
Uh,